So we're going to put our cabinet parts on the side for now. We'll get back to those in a little bit. And I want to turn my attention to the legs. Now, as much as I'd love to take the leg blanks and just make our curves and call it a day, we actually do have to think ahead again here. We have to think about, how are these legs going to attach to the cabinet sides? Do we want to do any joinery there? And also, what type of hinges are we going to use? Because the hinges are going to actually be installed in the legs and also on the doors, of course. So I put some thought into it. Originally, I was going to go with knife hinges, and then I gave it a little bit more thought and decided, you know what? Let's go talk to the people who know the most about this stuff. Let's go to Woodcraft and see if anybody can help us out with some of the hardware for this project. So that's exactly what we did, and I think you're going to enjoy this segment. Check it out. We're here with Frank at the our local Woodcraft store, and I brought him a sample, or at least, well, it's kind of a sample, of the cabinet, the Gadget Station that we're making, to show him the scenario and why it's unique. And basically, I want to just get his advice on what hinges he might recommend, what other options are out there, and what things, more traditional hinges, might not work in this scenario, because it is kind of a unique setup here. In most cases, a door, even if it's an inset door, it's usually flush with the front. In this case, we've got a curved front leg here that makes it not only not flush, but very difficult to, you know, figure out what type of hinge you need.
Exactly.
So if you could, get us started with a few recommendations. We'll cover some things that may not work and, you know, see some things here that I've never used before, so I'm really anxious to see what you've got.
Four different things that you need to consider when you're choosing your hinges. And one of the first and foremost, I think, when especially in doing a project like this, is aesthetics. How good does it look?
Of course.
After that, you need to look and see what the functionality is. If you're dealing with doors that are heavy, obviously you can't use slight, you know, flimsy hinges, or you can't handle the weight.
Sure.
The next one is cost, because some of these hinges are fairly inexpensive. A couple of these are like $3 or $4 a door, and others are coming up to $26, $30 a door.
Right.
And if you start dealing with a couple doors, you're getting into some money.
Absolutely.
It's something that people usually don't look for. And the other part will be just how much work does it take to put them in? Because some of these hinges that we're going to talk about are very easy to install. I think anyone can just pick them right up. Mm-hmm. And others, we're dealing with some pretty complicated Morrisine work, a lot of hand tool work. It's not something that you're just going to throw together. It's going to take some time, and it's going to show your craftsmanship.
So would you say that as a person is developing a strategy for their project and designing the project, that the more they know about hinges and what options are out there for them, they should really start to think about that before the final design? Because you can make one slight little change that could make a real difference in a hinge that's incredibly difficult to apply versus one that's easy. So, I mean, you should probably be thinking about these things early on in the process.
Exactly, and also thinking about just the basic model of how the door works.
Yeah.
Because is it going to be an inset door, which is what this is,
right?
Or is it going to be sitting on the face?
Like an overlay.
They all have their advantages and disadvantages. The disadvantage of this one is that if you make any mistakes, if the alignment isn't perfect, it stands up.
Yeah.
But in this case, just like you said, you're set in this direction. You're not going to go another way. So
right.
We need to find the right solution for your door.
And this is one of those cases where I did the opposite of what I just recommended doing. I designed this based on, I made it look exactly the way I wanted it to look and said, okay, now what hinge can I use for this?
Correct.
Which can bite you in the butt sometimes, but I think in this case we've got some good options here. So I'll put this down so it's not in our way. But
so let's talk about some of the hinges that are available. I don't think necessarily they're all suited for this project, but let's talk about them. I'll talk about one of my favorites first. This is, we commonly call it the Euro hinge. It was meant for cabinetry, and you'll see a ton of it. Anytime you look in the kitchen or garage cabinets, you're going to see a lot of these.
Oh, yeah.
They're very strong. And what I like about them is, even though they look very complicated for an installation, they're actually very easy. For $10, you can get a very usable template and the Forstner bit you need to make the section out here. Let's call it a hole.
Right.
Very complicated.
The round hole.
Anyway, one of the things I like about them is not only easy to install, but they're easy to adjust.
Yeah.
All these, if you make a mistake on most of these hinges, you start over again. You redo your door, or you're going to recut it.
Mm-hmm.
Here, you got adjustments where you can up, down, backwards, and forwards. All these adjustments are available to you. So if it's a little off, you can correct it.
Yeah.
That's what I really like, especially at the beginning.
And doors don't always stay in the same position that you started out in. You know, I mean, as the seasons change, things might warp a little bit. And I've actually done adjustments on doors where they've moved over the course of a few seasons. And those six-way adjustable hinges are just fantastic for
that. Exactly. You got to deal with wood movement. And sometimes you end up with the door droops a little bit, especially if it's a large, heavy door.
Yeah.
And this just makes things easier. And they'll handle a lot of abuse. I mean, that's why they put them in kitchen cabinets, because cabinets actually get a lot of abuse.
Right. I guess the only drawback of those would be the more industrial, commercial look.
Exactly. They are not pretty. I mean, obviously from the outside, you can't see them. You're blind to it, but the second you open, it says, oh, those are very nice cabinet you made there, Mark. It's very impressive.
Yeah, they're great, very functional, just not as nice as some of these other options.
Exactly.
Okay.
The next one I'd like to talk about is just a simple butt joint, but this is mortarless. That means that the only work you're going to do here is you're going to do alignment and you're going to screw them in. So.
Okay.
That's a big advantage over every other one of the ones here, because you're going to have to do some sort of mortising work, some fancier work. Mm-hmm. Here, all you really need to do is lay it out properly.
Okay.
This is probably the most common hinge right here. It is a standard butt joint hinge.
Right.
And this is what you'll see a lot of, especially in older cabinets. This is what they used almost exclusively.
Mm-hmm.
How you install it is up to you. I mean, there's a lot of different ways. Most of the time you see a decent craftsmanship, you're going to see two mortises at least. One on the door and one on the case.
Sure, sure.
But the biggest mistake I see people making is they can obviously look at the hinge itself and they mortise that out, but they forget that you have to include the pivot point, because that alters. There's a little gap there. You have to make sure that that lines up and that's straight.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it really shows.
Sure.
We talked about this earlier on the project, because I think this is what you initially had in mind.
Yeah, initially, until I came into the store today. So, let's definitely cover these, because
These are really nice hinges. They're beautiful. You're not going to see a lot of them, because actually when you put it in the case, you're only going to see the very little section of the hinge. But the downfall, one of the downfalls anyway, is the craftsmanship it takes to put these knife and offset hinges in. It's a lot. You're going to mortise both the door and the casework, and it's not just a nice little pretty straight cuts. You're going to have to deal with these offset hinges. Exactly.
Speaking of good craftsmanship, don't use CA glue to glue your joints together. That's just a sample. But yeah, you could see in here, you could see why I was leaning toward this design, because the hinge would be installed in that fashion like that. So it just seemed like the most logical thing. The craftsmanship behind these, it takes some skill. It's essentially an inlay, really.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you're inlaying that into the wood, both the door and the frame, you know, the body of the cabinet. So.
And one of the challenges is when you're going to be putting in two, these have to be perfectly aligned.
Yeah.
If they're off a little bit, your door is going to either sway a little bit or not open at all, because it'll hit the bottom. These have to be perfect alignment. So
Nicole has a jewelry box that has very tough to open doors, because it was my first set of knife hinges.
Yeah. So. And that's hard to correct. I mean, how do you correct that?
You
build the door again.
Yeah, it's trouble.
So these are offset because the hinge is away from here. These are considered the straight knife hinges, where it's in line.
Mm-hmm.
And it depends on how your door is laid out to which ones you're going to choose.
Okay. Great.
The next ones we were talking about was one of our favorites here. Is a standard barrel, and for installation, it can't get much easier, because all you really have to do is align two holes.
Right, yeah.
Exactly. That's all there is to it.
It's very simple.
The only downfall I can think of it is they're not super strong. So if you had a heavier door in particular, you may not want to choose these.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Which is one of the reasons I was kind of leading you towards this road. They have all the similarities of a barrel, but there's a lot more strength involved.
It sort of reminds me of a deadbolt on a big door, you know, like
full-size
deadbolt. So that looks very strong.
The package and the website doesn't really give you what the rated value is on how much weight you can put on it. But if you just put them in your hand, you can feel the weight and the strength of it. It's substantial.
You'll
be able to put
a
pretty heavy door on these.
Yeah, honestly, I think this is where I'm leaning now at this point. It looks like it might be quite a bit easier to install, and it's going to be strong. So.
I'd still recommend that you develop some sort of jig. They sell a jig from directly from the manufacturer.
Okay.
But it's something you could do on your own. And obviously, like everything else, you practice on scrap wood first, and then you put it on the project.
Right. Now, just one quick question as an aside. I know, like these, for instance, Brusso hinges are incredibly expensive. I mean, when you compare these to other brands, and there are, you know, some other brands on the internet that I've picked up for knife hinges, what would you say is the main reason why someone would want to go with this versus one of the cheaper brands? What are they really getting for that extra money?
You'll see at some of the less expensive brands, the materials aren't as good, the craftsmanship isn't as good. If you look at the Brusso's, this is a fine piece of craftsmanship here.
Very well milled.
Everything is milled very straight. All the cuts are very well done. They've done their job on the polish. They've made things very consistent. And, you know, these are made in Brooklyn, New York. You know, you can't get much more American than
made
that.
Made on the East Coast,
exactly.
Just like me.
And you get some of the other ones, the off-brands or the Chinese-mades. Mm-hmm. The metal starts getting thinner.
Yeah.
The holes aren't as consistent. And the holes have to be perfect.
Yeah.
These are all countersunk. There is no movement on there. There's no adjustability like there is on these. If you're off, you got a problem, right?
You're
going to have to drill those holes back out, plug them back up, let that dry,
sure.
And then redrill your holes.
Right, okay.
So the craftsmanship and the quality is what you're paying for.
Okay.
And if you just anticipate, if you just look at your project and say, well, hinges is part of my project, I'm going to have to add, you know, $60 to my project, mm-hmm. because I want quality hinges, then this is the way you're going to want to go.
I've used both, and I definitely would say they make a huge difference.
Right.
You know, if they're all milled perfectly, it's going to make a big difference in your level of accuracy and actually inlaying that into the wood.
And people look at the hinges, and if they see something that's poorly coated, mm-hmm. if it doesn't look quality, they're just going to assume the rest of it matches.
Yeah, absolutely.
And if you're going to put that much time in the material and the wood, you might as well spend just a little bit more on the
sure.
hinges. We didn't even talk about
this big guy here.
This is a continuous hinge or a piano hinge.
Mm-hmm.
Very strong. People underestimate just how much weight one of these will handle.
Yeah.
And you don't have to buy it to size. You can cut with a hacksaw any length you need.
Oh, cool.
And I actually like these. They're actually fairly easy to install.
Mm-hmm.
They're strong, and they're not terribly expensive. So
it definitely looks like these invisible hinges are what I'm going to go for. I really didn't even know these existed, so I'm really glad I came in, because this is a very cool thing. So we'll go over this on the show, installing these. You know, by some chance, maybe I'll change my mind on the way home and we'll go with knife hinges. I don't know. But I really am pretty convinced that this was the way to go. And the magnetic little catch is probably the way we're going to go as well.
I think it's a wise way to go. Overall, they don't stand out. They're not going to change with style. That's one of the
right.
problems that happens with hinges,
mm-hmm.
is you put the certain style and then you fall out of favor, or, you know, it comes out and people can go, oh, that looks 70s there.
Yeah. Well, I guess if it's possible, you shouldn't necessarily have to notice the hinge. If you can keep it as mm-hmm. Inconspicuous as possible, you're probably better off anyway for design purposes.
I want people to concentrate on that spalted maple.
Yeah, yeah. And the front of this is going to have spalted maple on it, so...
No, I
You're
saw
a smart
your
man.
Show.
Oh, okay. Never mind. Well, Frank, thanks a lot, man.
You
I
bet.
Appreciate it. It was great. And, well, let's get back to the shop so we can install these puppies.